Hello, my name is Willy Taro. I work for Shaproxy Technologies. I'll bring a quick overview about what led me to work on this project. A long time ago, around 2000, I was used to run a lot of network benchmarks on firewalls, proxies, antivirus, load balancers, etc. And I didn't find tools which were performant enough to stress these devices. And I had to write my own tools. I started with a program Inject, which is a client. It just performs a HTTP request as fast as possible through a device, and I was used to run it against an Apache or THTTPD server, and it was still not enough. And a friend of mine wrote a nice and smart server. Basically, you request it an object size, it builds this object on the fly and returns it. It was much faster than what we used to have, but it used to be fine for a few years, but in 2003, I started to run some benchmarks against Netfilter, which was already working really well, and these tools were not enough again. What I faced was the need for a lot of machines. To stress a single firewall, I needed to have two clients and two servers minimum. And all my clients were full CPU. At this point, I thought, but my server is doing something really dumb. Do I need to stress the TCP stack of the server and to do that much work to benchmark, to stress the firewall? Maybe I should reuse all these machines for the clients and maybe keep only a small one for the server and have a really dumb server. So one of the reasons for the performance issues I was facing back then, and which are still true, when you want to stress network equipment in practice, you don't need to test with large packets, because this what works the best. What stresses especially stateful components is to test with small packets and small connections. This was the most stressful as well for the TCP stack. The connection processing in the kernel is one bottleneck. In fact, there are locks at some point. There are table lookups to find a source port, for example. Everything costs a lot. And even a file descriptor management, when you perform the close at the end of a connection, it's very expensive as well. And the packet processing is expensive, because the packets flow through multiple layers in the kernel, and they are modified or completed, I would say. All this comes with a high cost. So I thought maybe one improvement could be to try to build a completely stateless server. Maybe we don't need at all this connection processing, and we can skip this. So it would come with a number of trade-offs, of course. I was ready to accept a number of them, such as supporting only short connections. I mean, I didn't need to stream 1 megabyte of data over the wire, because my tools worked already very well for this. I didn't care at all about security consideration, because my purpose was to build stress tools, not something for production. The tools needed to be optimized for throughput, so they didn't need to comply very well. I mean, to be very picky about the traffic I was sending, and it was my goal to have proper tools in front of them to send valid traffic. So if they did something unexpected when receiving a bad request, I didn't care. It was just my role not to do this. And however, the tools had to comply with the TCP spec, because when you are testing a component, if your tools are really crappy and do something really odd, when you tell a product vendor that his product fails on something and he sees your traces and he says, hey, these ones don't look valid, they will not consider your report. So I wanted really to have something compliant with the TCP spec. How can we build a TCP server from scratch without keeping any state? You still need to have a state because you can't find everything you need just in packets. Packets have different meanings for the same packets depending on the state. I will show you after. So there are places in the packets where we can store some elements to know the current state. The flags are a good indication. You can't store a lot of things in them, but they are useful. The sequence numbers, they move between multiple packets, so they can be helpful. The timestamp would be really nice, but since they are not mandatory, you cannot rely on them because some clients will not support them. So I abandoned this idea of using TCP timestamps. So it was 2003. I was not really skilled on TCP. I tried and I failed miserably. So I was back to improving my my old tools, made inject a multiprocess, and I wrote HTTP term to replace size SRV with a few more features and a better performance. But I was still not able to achieve a line rate on small objects, and as machines became faster and net filter improved, it was even harder to stress such components. A lot of time has elapsed since then. I've been mostly involved in working on HA proxy and constantly trying to optimize it and to save every single syscall or packet which was possible, and spent a lot of time running benchmarks. As I explained last year, I like to play with very small devices because I find them more convenient for such testing than running with a big infrastructure. And I discovered some nice boxes which came recently running on Marvel processors, Armada 370 and Armada XP, which are really powerful in terms of network performance. And I noticed while debugging or troubleshooting or trying to improve the NetEye driver, which is the Ethernet driver, that it was line rate capable, which means that you can saturate the wire with any packet size, and it is the hardware, and not the driver, but at least the hardware is capable of dealing with that many packets. Line rate at 1 gigabit is 1,488,000 packets per second. It's really, really fast. And even some large PCs with common network cards are not able to do this just because of some PCI access limitations or whatever you can face. So I thought that it was quite interesting. The devices are cool, they are cheap, they are not very powerful, but nice enough. My HTTP term was not running very fast on them, not enough to test a large PC running NetFilter. But I thought that there was something to do with this hardware and the driver. So, in parallel, Platome offered me this box, which is on the photo, an OpenBlox AX3. It's a nice box. It runs an Armada XP at 1.3 gigahertz. There are four gig ports, each on a separate controller on the CPU. It's extremely powerful for such processing, so I thought it was a good opportunity to try to revive my my old ideas. So, and I also had a project of building a bridge to perform a line rate sniffing, because when you are not limited by the packet size, you can imagine putting the box in cut through between two wires and sniffing the traffic in the middle, and it was an interesting project. I did not really succeed to do this because of some issues. For example, when you want to store some packets on a block device, you have to sleep, and you cannot do that when you are in a soft IRQ context. So I could only store in memory. It was not really useful. So with all these ideas in mind, I started to think, maybe we could do something. Maybe I could have a task, for example, in case of the sniffer, which would be able to sleep and store pages on the disks. And I was thinking again about my old HTTP server, which could maybe be attempted again. So a few new ideas started to appear in my mind about this. In parallel, at work, we were testing for an internal project a few packet processing frameworks. Maybe you know some of them. Netmap, which was originally done for FreeBSD, but which also works on Linux. PFRing, and Intel's DPDK. DPDK is a completely user space, by the way. All of them are capable of processing line rate traffic and forwarding at line rate, even on a 10 gigabit NICs. But they are all designed to process packets in user land. And in fact, they implement what they call a data plane. They are made for building, for example, a switch or router or whatever you can imagine. And they consider that the local TCP stack is just what they call the control plane, which is basically to SSH into the device or run a BGP server. You know, so they don't care really much about the performance of the local delivery of packets. And they use NetIFRX to deliver packets. It's the same function which is used by the tunnel devices. It's really not performant at all. So while they are able to process very fast data rate in user land, it's not possible to achieve a reasonable performance when dealing with the kernel. And in my case, it was a problem because I work on HAProxy. It performs very well on Linux. It benefits from Linux TCP stack, and I wanted to use Linux TCP stack. I didn't want to try to re-implement something in user land. It didn't make sense at all. So I wanted to have very high performance on a component I would put in front of HAProxy and still not affect the performance of HAProxy running through the TCP stack. So I thought something different was needed. And I realized that the two requirements I had at work and at home in my own projects were a bit similar. So I started to imagine a new framework which could basically inspect incoming packets without affecting the performance. Which would pass these packets to the local stack without affecting performance as well. I had the need for dropping packets, for example, when you want to filter or whatever, you want to be able to drop packets, so it was necessary. I wanted to be able to respond to packets. If I want to build an HTTP server, I have to emit some packets, and if I want to do this as fast as possible, I need to do this when I receive one. It was a bit complicated, but it was a prerequisite. And I thought that a network framework without any application to test it is useless, because we all know a lot of frameworks which do nothing without any example code. So it was a good opportunity to try again the stateless HTTP server. So I tried again. I will start with a quick reminder about TCP. I won't enter into details. If you want to see the details, please check the RFC. But a few points which are mandatory to understand to see what I will be doing there. First, TCP is not a single stream, but two opposite streams. Each of them are independent. In each packet, you have some flags which describe the local state of the connection. So you inform the other end of what you are trying to do, what the status of the connection is on your side. Packets carry a sequence number. The sequence number is simply describes the position of the packet in the stream, and this position is expressed in number of bytes. So you have a certain sequence number at some point. You send, for example, 100 of bytes, and the next sequence number will be a 100 above. It's very simple in practice. There are special flags, thin and fin. The first one is used to initiate a new connection. The second one is used to close the connection. These flags need to be acknowledged, and by convention, they count as one byte. So it's exactly as if I was sending one byte when they are present. Each side selects its own initial sequence number. We don't start at zero. We can, but we don't start at zero. And one very, very interesting thing for my use case was that the ACK field reflects the next expected sequence number. So I was already thinking that it could be used as a cookie. You see, I send a sequence number. Since it is echoed back, I said, maybe something is doable. And you're supposed to acknowledge that I'm writing almost any data or thin packet that you receive. I'm saying almost because in practice it's common that if you send two packets, only the last one will be acknowledged, just to avoid saturating links with useless ACKs. But in practice we can consider that all packets are acknowledged. And in case of a stateless server, I will have to retransmit in case of packet losses. So this is not compatible with being stateless, but I have in front of me a stateful client with a real TCP stack, and it already handles the retransmit for me, so I don't have to care about the retransmits. What a typical HTTP connection looks like? Generally, it's seven packets. You have a first packet, so you have the client on the left. I can zoom, maybe. You have the client on the left, the server on the right. The client sends a packet with a thin flag. It receives a packet with a thin and a ACK. It sends an ACK. It sends a request. You'll notice a push flag, which I wrote PSH, which is only used to indicate the other end that the packet needs to be delivered quickly to the application. You see this, for example, with SSH, Telnet, or every HTTP request or response. The server responds, closes the connection. The client acknowledges the close of the connection and also sends a thin packet. And the server acknowledges the last thin packet, and the connection is terminated. And you have the server, which remains, its socket is supposed to remain in time-wet state, which is why you are seeing a lot of time-wet sockets on your web servers if you look at netstat output. Here we see the operations I need in my framework, be able to reply to some packets, and drop some packets. I have not represented the need to pass the packets to the local stack, because my purpose is not to use the local stack here. However, my project will intercept only some traffic and not everything. So all the rest needs to be delivered to the local stack. Here we'll enter a bit more into details. You're seeing at the top that the sequence number sent by the client is acknowledged by the server with the same number plus one, because as I said, thin counts as one byte. You're seeing that the response sent by the server acknowledges the number of bytes sent by the client in the request and the next sequence number from the client. And you'll see below that the thin counts again as one. So we are at the end, what we acknowledge is the number of fin plus sin plus the size of the request. Now, if you look at what I have to send in the sequence numbers, the initial sequence number is selected by the server here, so I can put whatever I want in it. In practice, I believe that I simply reuse the same as the client, but I don't remember because I had multiple implementations. For the response, the sequence number is simply the same as last one plus one. And in the last hack, it's plus two plus the response size since I have sent some bytes. So the next sequence number should be the number of bytes I sent plus the sin plus the fin. An HTTP connection can be simplified as well, and I wanted to deal with this because it's used a lot when you want to stress stateful tools. You can go down to five packets. So a sin hack, the request. You don't need the first hack, which is empty. It's not needed. So you send the request. The server responds with the fin to close the connection, and the client can simply reset the connection, which saves one packet, because instead of sending a fin, it sends a reset, and the server does not need to hack it. So it's three packets from client to server, and two packets from server to client. When you are running in HTTP Keep Alive, you repeat the request response pattern as long as you want, and the packet computation still works well. So since we don't add fin packets in the middle, it's not a problem. So it's very easy to stack multiple requests on top of the same connection. So in practice, the design looks simple now. First, we need to drop a number of packets. I ended up simplifying the rule. Everything which does not contain either data or a fin or a sin should be dropped. For example, you receive a reset, you don't need it, you must not respond to a reset, you drop it. It's very simple. You need to respond to a sin with a sin hack. And you have to carefully choose your sequence number, because I will try to use the sequence number to store some information. I need to recognize the sequence number in the that the client will send me in the acknowledgement, so that's why I need to carefully pick the sequence number, in fact. I need to know which state the client is going to reflect when I'm seeing a packet from the client. Sending the sequence number is very simple. In practice, the sequence number is always the same as the hack I got from the previous packet from the client. It's exactly what I was saying, that the hack field of a packet, reflects the next expected sequence number. So in practice, the client carries this information for me, I don't have to store it. The acknowledgement is simply the last sequence number from the client plus the number of bytes which were carried in the packet. Plus one if there is a fin, plus one if there is a sin. So I have all the information again in the client's packet. I need to send a response when I receive a request. This is an important point, in fact. Sometimes you will see in some traces when a server is slow to respond, you will see the request come. And after some time, the server will send just an acknowledgement so that the client knows the packet was correctly delivered, and the server is processing the request and then responding. And one critical principle of the stateless server is that I am using the client to send some traffic so that I can respond to this traffic. I must never acknowledge anything which will make the client think I'm doing something and will respond afterwards. because since I need the client to send me something to respond to it, I must ensure that the client always asks me to do something. So I must never acknowledge a request, for example, just send an ACK to say, hey, okay, I received your request, now I'm waiting a little bit and sending the response. It's not possible, because if the client receives my acknowledgement and not the second packet which carries the response, it will not retransmit anything because the request was already acknowledged. And I need his next packet to know that I have to wake up and send a response. The thin flag is needed on the last response. So if I want to support keep alive, in fact, it's very easy, as I said, multiple requests one at a time, and I just then send the thin flag on the last response, and that's all. And I realized while writing these slides that the same design could possibly work for TCP fast open with just a few changes. I have not tried it yet. So we need a few states in practice that we want the client to send us back. I have given them small names. The first one is a request state. We are waiting for a request from the client. For example, we have already sent an ACK a CNAC packet. We are waiting for a request, so we need to detect this state. And if we are working in keep alive mode and have already sent a response, we need to know from the next packet from the client that we are already again dealing with a new request. We need a special state which I called ACK. There are some cases where the client may send the fin before us. For example, the client decides to close before the server for whatever reason. It can happen. This is a special state because we must not expect any more data from the client in this case. So it needs a special state. We have a closed state, which is the last one where no, it's not the last one, sorry. We have already sent the fin packet. It was not ACK, however, all the data were ACK. Some clients, I mean some TCP stacks in practice, will acknowledge responses in two parts. For example, if you have a packet which carries a response and a fin flag, some will send the first acknowledgement for the data and the second one for the fin flag. So we need to detect this case as well, and to react accordingly. And the fin state, everything was acknowledged. So in fact, I need to represent four states. Four state is 2 bits, so it's not much. So I can encode them in the sequence numbers because there are 32 bits, so I can sacrifice 2 bits. But as I said, sequence numbers are used to carry an amount of data. So I just have to adjust the amount of data I'm going to send to ensure that my packets are always the proper size so that I don't affect the last 2 bits of the sequence number by sending data. And then I can just adjust the size of the data to adjust the state. So, another point. It's written here. Here the design is simplified with four state. My original implementation used 16 states because I wanted to send a larger response in multiple packets. But in practice, it was not reliable because a client could ACK in some of them in the middle. And if my response was lost, it would not ask for a retransmit. So I have abandoned this design. It's nice on the loopback, but that's all. So that's what I explained. All data is sent in multiple of 2 bytes. I have added a header XPAD just to send a number of bytes to adjust the size to the multiple of 4 I want. And I need to remember that the fin flag counts as one. So if I'm going to send a fin flag, for example, I send one less byte in the expat header. I have to deal with a request to request transition, which is basically no transition when doing HTTP keep alive. So I receive a request. I have an ACK field from the client, which is zero in the last two bits. When I send my response, it must be a multiple of four, so that when the client acknowledges my response, I still have zero in these last two bits to know that the client is sending me a new request. And there are a few dependencies between the states. In fact, this is the part I failed in 2003. I was not able to correctly write the state machine, and this time I managed to do it. The ACK must equal exactly the request state plus one to deal with the fin flag. And the fin must equal exactly the close state plus one, in fact, for the same reason. So there are some state transitions which are forced by the protocol itself. But fortunately, not all the dependencies are forced by the protocol, which made this design possible. So I was very hurried and impatient to try this. So when you want to try some packet processing, the first idea is to go with NFQ. It's very easy to write some code and some proof of concept to this. I already achieved a very high performance. It was running in userland. The packets are copied between the kernel and the userland. But despite this, the performance was really good. 33,000 connections per second on the small device you saw on the photo. It was doing, I think it was 24,000 using the TCP stack. And even faster on my core 2. Then I was noticing that I was spending a lot of time switching between user and kernel. So I improved the design. It was a bit dirty. I started from the code of the Jumi interface, and I modified the output path. The idea was that I was dealing with TX packets. So I send the packet, I pretend there is a machine somewhere on the network behind the Jumi interface, and my code intercepts these packets and builds the responses. So I can use them locally. For example, I can inject through the Jumi interface from the loopback, from the local machine, I mean. Or I can do it from another machine by enabling IP forwarding, because the Jumi interface is just a standard interface. And I achieved a much better performance. To get an idea, this performance is basically twice what I was doing initially with my program HTTP term using the TCP stack. And it was really reliable, and the performance was very, very stable, much more than when using a userland daemon. I improved a bit the code, because initially it was dirty, no checksums were checked, etc. So, but anyway, I did just a minor work to have a proof of concept. I improved to support GET and HEAD requests, to parse the connection header to know if I needed to deal with a close request or a keep alive request, then meaning that the client could be able to send a new request. So it was great. I concluded that it was a good proof of concept. I already had better performance than what I used to have initially. But now I was impatient to put that into the network driver. Sorry for the size. So back to thinking about how to design a framework which would be able to run this code and which would also be compatible with the requirement I had for my job, as I explained before. First observation on such a small devices like the Armada XP, you have a small cache, a small L1 cache. Might be 16 kilobytes, I believe. I'm not even sure, maybe even less. And some devices have sometimes only 1 kilobyte. So we don't want to copy the packets too often. And that was one of the problems I was facing with a framework like NetMap. NetMap doesn't copy the packets. It provides you with a mapped area where the data is, but it spends a lot of time building large descriptors with pointers to many places. And building this means basically that you are thrashing all the L1 cache because the table doesn't fit in the cache. So I wanted to change this. I also found that for the same reason, working with these descriptors, if I wanted to avoid descriptors, I wouldn't have any other possibilities than running into the kernel. Otherwise, I have to build a table of the packets, their size, their pointers, etc. So, if I am in the kernel, I can access everything directly with the real pointers, and I don't need to build these translation tables. Another point, at first I was not fond of this, and after a few tests I was convinced. Most modern CPUs have very efficient branch prediction units. They are able to cache in the branch target buffer, for example, the place where you jumped last time. So in practice, when you call a function now, it's almost transparent. It comes with no cost. And it's much cheaper than building descriptors, for example. So I thought, finally, maybe it's better to have simply a callback in the driver to call my functions for every incoming packet. Maybe it could work. In practice, it did. If I call functions directly with a packet, I don't need to build descriptors anymore. I can simply pass all the relevant information in arguments, in the functions argument. The first arguments are passed as registers, so I don't need to write or to read anything from memory. It was interesting as well because it means the code is really compact, very few data manipulation. So there was good hope from this. Sometimes you can be scared about modifying a network driver to add your code in it. In fact, what takes time is to understand how the driver works. But once you find your way in the driver, you say, okay, all the packets pass at this point. So I can put my code here. Now, is it efficient or not? Maybe I need to be before this point, but it's easy to find your way. It's just a matter of spending a bit of time to understand all the driver's design. Another thing I learned from NetMap. NetMap was great, but it lacked an important feature. Many network cards right now have a lot of optimization possible. For example, they compute a CRC checksums for you. They can do some segmentation of loading. They can do many things. Some of them will tell you about the protocols which are transported. They will tell you whether your IP header has some options, for example. They can tell you a lot of things. And a framework like NetMap only gave you the packet, the raw packet, and tell you, hey, you have everything in this, and you have to do all the job yourself while the NIC has already done it. So I thought, I want to change this design. I want to design for the best network cards available. And if something is not done by the network card, it's the driver's job to fill the gap. It's not the application to do all the job which was already done by some NICs. So it means that the cheaper NICs will have more code in the driver, and the most expensive NICs, which do a lot of things, will probably have a lot less code. In practice, it's not true, but at least it's what I thought. Also, I noticed that in my first proof of concept, that my code was mostly focused on parsing the packets. Since the NIC has a lot of information, For example, you need to parse the packet headers just because you need to know the packet length. You need to know if you have some IP option which push the TCP header further. So just to know the place of the initial data, you have to parse a lot of things. This takes time. I mean, it can seem ridiculous because we are talking about just a few CPU cycles. But when you are running on small devices at 1.5 million packets per second, every CPU cycle counts. So I said, if I have this information from the NIC or from the driver, because sometimes some checks have already been done, let's pass this information to the application. So the L2, L3, L4 locations are passed directly to the application so that it can play with this if it doesn't care about whatever is in the lower layers. Similarly to the previous point, I found that in my initial proof of concept, it was painful to in the application. What I call the application is a stateless server, to have to build the checksum and to do a number of things. When I know that the NIC is capable of doing this, I don't see why the application would have to do this. So the point was to let the application be able to say, I have already computed the checksum for you, for example, because I'm routing some packets and I don't want to alter it. Or, I have not done this work, please do it. So the application can delegate some of its work to the lower layers. For the response, it was not easy because I needed to have some pre-allocated buffers. The purpose is that when I receive a packet, I call the application tells me, hey, please send this packet back. And I don't want to allocate a packet at this place. It can be extremely expensive. So I need to have a pool of pre-allocated packets. And in fact, that's most of the job in the drivers is just to handle a pool of pre-allocated packets and managing their allocation. So anyway, it works, but it was the most difficult part. I also found when working on the sniffer, because I wanted to, I still want to have a sniffer. Sometimes you want to flush the work which was started. For example, imagine that I'm just writing a simple sniffer. Every incoming packet is copied to my application. It has to buffer this packet somewhere. I don't want to write these packets to disk or whatever at this point, first because it's not possible, but I don't want either to wake up maybe another task every time I receive a packet because it is expensive. But what could be convenient is to be woken up a last time by the driver to say, I have nothing else for you, finish your job. And that's what the RxDone function does. So if any packet was received and passed to the application, then this function is called and the application knows it can flush its pending work. It's very efficient for a sniffer because you can work in a pre-allocated buffer, you push your data there, and on RxDone, you just wake up the application waiting for this data. And NAPI is very useful. I discovered this when implementing the response code, because when you are running under NAPI, you know that you are not interrupting anyone else. So, for example, if you can grab a queue or something when you are there, your work is not interrupted, you are not interrupting someone else, so your execution is consistent during this this phase. It's very important. It avoids a lot of locking and many, many problems. If we zoom on what it could mean for a driver, you have the NIC which is represented above, so the hardware, I mean. Below, you have the network stack. Between the driver and the NIC, there are TX descriptors and RX descriptors. When we send some packets, a function is called the XMIT function. Here we intercept this function to call what we name handle TX. This function decides if it needs to pass the packet or drop it. So this is for the outgoing path. And in the Rx path, we pass the packet to the applications under Rx this time. We decide if we want to drop it, to pass it to the application, to send a response immediately. Or it's not used here, but we can also modify the packet and announce a different size. For example, we could use this to decapsulate some VLAN or I don't know. I didn't have this this requirement for now, but I'm sure it can be useful sometimes. Strangely, the framework is only a .h file. I didn't have to write a single C file because I was just providing a few functions to register a handler, and there were 2, 3, 4 lines sometimes. Just inline functions were fine. Here you see the prototype of the structure itself. You have a pointer to the device, a pointer to the handle TX, handle RX, RX done, and that's all. One of the points is to know how a driver knows that a handler is attached to a network interface. Because when the driver receives packets, it needs to know if it needs to call an application or not. There are 2 unused pointers in Ethernet devices. One of them is the one I reused. It was also the same one used by NetMap, by the way. And the other one, I don't remember. But this one is not used for Ethernet devices. It's just for another class of network cards. So it was always null, so it was possible to reuse it freely. So it's a bit of a dirty hack, but I needed to have some place to put my pointer. Also, some architectures have very few registers. For example, when you are running on i386, you can't mangle too many registers, otherwise you are again pushing these registers to memory. So if I want to use register to avoid memory accesses, and in the end I end up copying registers to memory, it's a bit of a failure. So I try to compact as much as possible all the information I wanted to pass to the application and put that in the registers. So that's what I call the composite values. So we limit the number of arguments to the functions. For example, above you will see flags L3 length, for example. There is a mix of flags and layer 3 packet lengths. That's the idea. We have 4 arguments, I believe, in addition to the pointer, 4 arguments. On some architectures, it can be done with a simply 5 registers, and other ones maybe only 2 and 3 other on the stack. And the registers, the arguments were ordered by a decreasing order of importance, because some applications do not necessarily need to access the last ones. Even if we push some arguments in memory, maybe we don't even need to access them. One trick I had to do caused me a lot of gray hair at the beginning. The NAPI interface requires that you inform it on the return function of the RX, the poll function, of the number of processed packets. In fact, in my case, it's not the number of processed packets, but the number of packets delivered to the local stack. So at the beginning, I was putting the real value there, and I had a lot of trouble. I realized that I needed to phase this number and keep an additional counter of the packets which were really passed to the TCP stack. So under Rx, it gets some arguments, some pointers to L2, L3 places. There is one reason for having two separate pointers for layer 2, layer 3. One is the presence or not of VLANs. So I don't want an application which needs only layer 3 to have to check the VLAN flag and know if it needs to add 4 or not to the layer 2. And another one is that some drivers will, or some NICs maybe, will deliver packets with some holes. So you can sometimes have a hole between layer 2 and the layer 3. So I thought, let's pass bus pointers. I said the flags mixed with the layer 3 lanes. So we have a number of flags in the higher 16 bits to indicate, for example, the type of protocol for the most common ones, whether or not the checksums were valid at layer 3, layer 4. In the lower 16 bits, the layer 3 lanes, and the fact that it is in the lower bits is on purpose. It's not just random because on some architectures it's easier to process these ones, for example, because we can perform a sign extension or zero extension very easily. I really want to save every single CPU cycle. It's very important. The VLAN ID and the protocol, the layer 3 protocol. So both of them use 16 bits. Similarly, the protocol is in the lower bits because some applications will simply use a lookup table, for example, to quickly branch to the protocol handler. The function returns some information back in 32 bits. The action, I said, we could drop a packet, we could ask to send another one. So the drop is what is mentioned, drop here. Pass means I deliver the packet to the local stack. Skip is a special case. For example, when you think about a sniffer, sometimes its buffer are full, so it cannot store anything else. So it just returns skip to say, hey, I have no room anymore, and the function stops, the Rx function stops delivering packets, and it's called later after NAPI polls again. If we want to modify packets or to send a packet, if we want to send, for example, we send a drop with a size, and having a size in return with a drop indicates we want, in fact, to build a new packet. It is delivered then in the pointer which was already passed. And we can also change the packet, as I said. If we say pass with a new size, if the size is different, it means the packet was modified. Which means, by the way, that I cannot inform the local stack that I mangled the packet without changing its size. But in fact, we don't really care. And a few other information, such as a layer 4 offset, for example, some drivers or some hardware will need to have this offset, since the application has modified the packet, when sending, has built, I would say, the packet, it knows where the pointer is. There is no need for the driver to compute it again. And the checksums, sometimes you have already computed your checksums, sometimes not. So better inform the driver whether it has to do it again or not. And whether or not there is a VLAN and the protocol. Eric's done, I said, I talked about it. Handle TX is very much simpler. It just takes an NSKB, which is the internal format of the packets in the kernel. It's not designed to modify the packets. It can only accept the packet and pass them through or drop them. It cannot respond back. I didn't see any use for this. I noted one point. Maybe later I will change the API to be able to modify the packet, because right now it's not possible since I have seen no use for this, but maybe one day some users will have a use for this. So I was impatient to test this on my devices. In one day, I got the code to work in the MVNeta driver. It didn't compute checksum or whatever, but it was enough to just perform a quick packet mirroring function. It took another day to implement a few extensions, such as checksum, VLAN, etc. All the flags, in fact, which are passed to the application to do something a bit smarter than just mirroring. I also had to perform some changes which took more time. I noticed something odd in network drivers. When a network driver is woken up on a receive event, I mean, the network card has already written all the data in memory, and the network driver will unmap all DMA descriptors one packet at a time. And on some architectures, we don't need to map or unmap these packets. We just need to have a memory barrier to say, just flush your cache or synchronize with the next layer. It's the same in practice. Just flush your cache to have the last packets in memory. And it happens that the way the API is done causes this flush to be done for every packet we process once at a time. It's very slow because while you are processing packets, when I say very slow, I'm a bit exaggerating, but when you are processing packets, the NIC is still delivering new packets to memory. So when you apply this barrier, in fact, you flush the cache again and it takes a lot of time. So I modified the API to be able to have just a barrier operation, which is called the entry point of the Rx function to say, okay, now I synchronize my cache with the memory and whatever I will see is up to date because I know that I will only process the packets that I'm seeing in the descriptors from the NIC. And I could significantly improve the receive performance this way. As I said, I had to implement a descriptor pool for takes packets. And a small trick to reduce the cost of locking when sending packets back, because you have to lock a TX queue so that nobody else is using the same queue as you when you want to send a packet. I don't want to lock the queue for each packet. I don't want to keep the lock during all the receive event, the receive loop. For example, you can have 500 packets at a time. So the trick was to say I lock the queue when I need to lock it first. I keep the lock, and I will only unlock it on the first packet, which does not need the TX lock anymore. So I keep the lock at most for one extra packet, and that's all. So in fact, if I need to respond a lot of packets, for example, in the mirroring code, just needs one lock for several hundred packets. And in other cases, maybe we will have the lock during two packets while we needed it only for one. And with just this, I already managed to achieve a line rate on the open blocks and even on the Mirror box, which is a smaller device with less memory bandwidth. So line rate means 1.5 million packets in each direction. So you send traffic to the device, it calls the Rx function, the Rx function says returns the MAC addresses, IP addresses, sends the traffic back, and I can saturate the gigabit port, whatever the packet size. So it's really cool because it means the concept is working. So, as you can guess, I wanted to port the stateless HTTP server on this. It was really fast because I already had two examples of code. It just binds to a number of ports. I specify your range, port low, port high, and it intercepts all such traffic and does not disturb the rest. I did not notice any performance impact on the local packet delivery. And in practice, it's able to saturate the Ethernet link for whatever request and response size. I have not written an article on my website on this and said that there was still a bottleneck at some point, and I didn't realize when I wrote the article that in fact it was a request which were too large, and the requests are saturating the link, preventing the response from saturating the link as well. So when you count the request size, the total request size, three packets, 368 bytes in total, times 340,000 connections per second, you have exactly 1 gigabit. It's around 12 times, maybe even 13 times faster than what the user code, the user land code was doing initially. To give you an example, to run my user land code on, at such speed, I would probably need around 3 or 4 core i7 servers. And just my small device, which is big like this, is able to achieve this on a single CPU core. So that's great. The current state is still experimental. We have been able to use it at my job on the Intel's 10 gig card. It was almost 1 month of development. The driver is very complex, but the NIC is able to do it both ways. A lot of things are still needed. I still cannot forward traffic. I cannot send traffic without receiving traffic. That's what I mean by a reactive processing. So if I want to flood a link, I still cannot do it using this framework. I need to hack a SOC packet or to do something else, and it's the end. As I said, I don't feel the need to mangle outgoing traffic. I want to implement it on the loopback. It can seem strange, but I realized that on my laptop to test HAProxy locally, I'm still using the old implementation which implements the Dummy interface. And I would like to port this framework to the loopback interface to be able to run the same code as on the real one. And at my work, we were able to capture at line rate at 10 gig. It's very cool in practice because you can sniff whatever traffic you want. Even at 10 gig, you don't lose any packet. No stats yet. And I found it was easier to implement in drivers which are already using a good SCABI. It's a function which ensures that we build the SKB just at the last time, and we don't store a cache of pre-allocated SKB packets. And there is much less work to do because we don't have to release the SKBs or put them somewhere else. It's easier. Quickly, some possible applications for the framework. So network testing, that was my initial purpose. I found that it was possible to measure latency by putting two mirrors face to face. So you want to measure the latency of a switch. It's very hard to measure very short latencies, but when you have the ability to make a ping pong between two ports at the fastest possible rate, you just have to count the number of packets per second. You do the divide, and you get the number of microseconds between the two ports. It can be used for this. Line rate capture, as I said, firewalling. Load balancing can be possible at layer 3 or layer 2 sometimes. The only thing is that I cannot forward packets, but there is a trick, in fact. Since I can mangle incoming packets before responding, we can use VLAN for this. So if I have a single port attached to a switch, I can receive some traffic from a VLAN, which is attached to a certain switch port, change the VLAN tag and send the packet back, and the switch will deliver it to another port. So it's a bit dirty hack, but it can be an option. And the stateless HTTP server is has much less usage, in my opinion. For testing, it's fine. I found also that it was usable to in what we call now the Internet of Things. So you want to have some temperature sensors or whatever, which return small responses which fit in one or two packets. You don't even need a TCP stack. You implement exactly the same principle. You have an Ethernet port. The client sends a valid request. You can access this device with a browser. I mean, it's really HTTP over TCP. And the device does not even understand HTTP, but it just applies the same principles and will deliver reliably your data. And to serve small static objects also, such as favicon.ico, it can be fun, but I don't really think it's reasonable for production, but why not after all? I know I'm late. Sorry for this. Two questions? No. Not at all, because in fact, I'm not even at this place. I'm on the Rx pass, so we get an interrupt because the NIC has delivered a lot of packets. It wakes up NAPI. NAPI calls the driver's poll function. And at this point, I don't have to communicate with anything else. There is even not the scheduler or whatever. I just call the application's functions very fast and return, and that's all. So it's very, very low latency, in fact. It was not the initial purpose, but it was a consequence of the design choices. Okay, so thank you. Ah. I would like to, but I need to implement it on some virtual NIC drivers. It's still not done. I know that it will be much less interesting because in a virtual server, you have already crossed all the hypervisor stack. So most of the job was already done here. And the purpose is to be the closest possible to the NIC. So I don't expect a lot of savings, to be honest. But at least to be able to run the same code I could run natively in a VM at some point, we will certainly port it. So the code is the experimental code is available. I hope that we will be able to deliver the patches on my company's website when we finish it by the end of the year. Thank you.